Very nice to introduce, very glad to introduce Dr. Sethi from New York, Columbia University. Amrita, what are you doing?
Hi there. Yeah, so we have a patient who has had 6 months of dysphagia to solids. Her prior endoscopy demonstrates a Zenker's diverticulum, just a little bit above 2 centimeters. So the plan here today is for a traditional Zenker's diverticulotomy or septotomy. It's the protocol here. A Humanitas if it's greater than 2 centimeters. But the interesting thing today is what we're going to show you is the use of this scope. This is the single AMBU single use gastroscope that's just become available. You can see it here in its packaging. It has a 9.9 millimeter outer diameter. The channel is 2.8 millimeters. So it very much reflects our current scopes that we're using. And very impressively, all you have to do to set this up is to plug it in right here and then attach your tubing for irrigation, suction, and insufflation. And the screen here, all this together makes up the entire console of this endoscope. So it's a perfect device for going to the emergency room, the ICU setting, anything you need, office-based endoscopy. We can connect it to our other monitors so we can adjust our view very well. And I think one of the things we hope to demonstrate today is that while this procedure doesn't necessarily fall into something that requires single use, it's certainly feasible for patients. It provides the same functionality as our reusable scopes. And more importantly, it may provide us with an ergonomic adjustability so that we also take care of ourselves as endoscopists. So I have a cap adjusted to the end of the scope. On this side is the diverticular side. We've previously placed a tube into the esophageal side so we can distinguish. I'm using a clear-cut L-type knife because we don't need anything too fancy to inject. We're just gonna cut. And so I'm gonna get ready to start doing that. We might just comment a little bit on the settings that we're using here.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Amrita, for. So if we can focus on the, here we have the Herbe Bio 200D. So this is our usual setting for Zenker. You see it's already pre-organized. So we go to endocut high, effect 1, 3, 3. And just in case of a little bleeding, we do not expect a massive bleeding here. We have a forced cog, effect 2, VAT is 80. So of course, we privilege this setting because we would like to have a very nice cut, but also a little bit of coagulation in order to prevent little oozing bleeding that may compromise the visibility of the cut that we're doing.
Yeah, so obviously the thing that we want to do here is make sure that we have a nice clean cut, but that we don't damage the mucosa on the esophageal side. So once we create a small tract here, I'm slowly catching the fibers. And I'm going to be careful as I come out that we don't touch the esophageal side.
In this case, the nasogastric tube is preventing also. It's helping you in preventing
exactly
collateral damage or transmural damage because it's just protecting the esophageal lumen. No?
Exactly. And our goal is to start to expose the muscle fibers so that we can make sure we don't go too deep. We want to obviously complete as much as possible of this myotomy, but we know that with this technique, as opposed to, for example, the Z-POEM technique, we are not going to go completely through. We want to spare one or two fibers in order to prevent perforation into the mediastinum, which can be one of the biggest complications that there is. So I'm just going to try to use the cap a little bit to help me. You can see we're exposing the muscle fibers there, beginning to. I might cut this way a little bit. And then we have enough room. We can catch the fibers like this. There you start to see the muscle. So of course we have no data just yet about whether or not which method is more effective. I think there is an ongoing randomized trial currently looking at Z-POEM versus this. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, Ali.
Well, there is a randomized trial organized by Michael Committee, which should have been part. We still stuck with the ethics committee approval because this kind of randomized trial now are very complex. They require insurance coverage, CRO, whatever. So we are waiting to be part of that. In the meantime, our feeling is that if the septum is bigger than 2 centimeters, either way, so traditional septotomy or third space septotomy, POIS, they work equally. Rather for septum which are shorter than 2 centimeters, we definitely go with the POIS approach. We have been the first in describing this POIS approach, just cutting along the vertical axis of the diverticulum, of the septum, and honestly, it works very well. Doesn't require too much effort. It's nice to see you clearly showing the muscle now, so you're approaching the cricopharyngeal muscle. So it's important to cut these fibers for 2 reasons. First, because there is a mechanical barrier, but the other reason is these are spastic fibers creating the condition of spasm at the hypopharynx or upper esophagus, probably creating the condition for the Zenker diverticulum. So as much as possible, these muscle fibers are to be cut. So probably going a little bit on the way, there will be more space to cut.
Yeah, let's just get the mucosa now. And sometimes you do see the muscle bundles separate.
Yeah, very nice. So what is your feeling with the scope, Amrita?
So I really find that the handling is just like my gastroscope. In fact, I was commenting a little bit earlier that it might even be just a little bit stiffer. So the response to the movement is very one-on-one. So I can use my body even a bit. So any of us who do resection where we use our body movement instead of doing too much manipulation with the knife itself, it's okay to do that. I mean, yeah. It works well.
So we have a couple
Amrita, and I can ask a question of you two.
Sure.
So Amrita, what's your go-to technique though for these procedures at this point in time before we have the RCT data?
So I have been tending to do a little bit more of Z-POEM. I'm very comfortable with that technique. And I like the idea of being able to do a really complete the myotomy. In fact, I even do some circular muscle fibers on the esophageal side, particularly when I am encountering patients who may have a little bit of hypertonicity at the base of the Zenkers. So that's been my go-to, but I do think there's a lot we still have to answer about whether it's truly that much more efficacious. And also, I know there's some question about whether or not the mucosal flap that is left over will end up being a problem and whether that excess needs to be cut.
Okay, thank you. So we'll have to wait for the RCT data. The other thing I want to ask is, do we know the costs of this single-use gastroscope?
I'll let Ali answer that because it's not yet available in the U.S., so I'm not sure what the cost is. We have to do
nice question. We don't know either, so it's interesting. It's interesting because we tried this scope a couple of weeks ago. We have done a couple of procedures, including operative procedures like band ligation, peg tube placement. So we were very happy. I think portability is an important part of this when we move to space outside endoscopy like ICU or emergency room. This will be very helpful. So of course, when we will be aware about the cost, we'll make our decision, our consideration. Of course, there is always pros and cons. And I think it's too early to determine this, but in general, I see there is a bright future for disposable. It's like the beginning of disposable biopsy forceps where everybody was using standard usable. At the end, in a few years, all moved to disposable. I have the same feeling, at least for certain kind of procedure, everything will move to the disposable part. So I think you're almost done, no?
I think so, yeah. We'll just cut this mucosa here.
Yeah.
So what's your rule of thumb as to when you stop? Because we don't want to see disappearance of the muscle fiber, then we will have gone too far down.
No, I think we can make a little cut just in the middle and we're done.
But you complete the procedure, then what's your general follow-up of these patients immediately after for the next 24 hours?
I can tell what we do here. First we do significant number of procedures. For Zenker, we do at least 2 cases per week since a couple of years now. So it's an average of 80 or 100 patients per year. So we have a protocol. As long as patient is in a good health, in good condition, doesn't have a too big comorbidities, We discharge the patients over evening. We make a first attempt to giving clear liquids 8 hours after the procedures. So we do recommend to start having semi-solid food or liquid diet in 12 hours. And we do not give antibiotics either before or afterwards. And reintroduction of anticoagulants is recommended in 2 days after the procedure. So this is our standard protocol.
Okay, great.
Okay. I think, Amrita, congratulations. This has been historical because it's the first live procedure ever with the disposable gastroscopic therapeutic procedure. Congratulations, big
Thank
achievement.
You.
Thanks also to Hamburg for supporting this event and for giving us the possibility of using this scope. I think there is a lot of future for this scope, a lot of things that we'll be doing.
And also it allows you to really change iterations very quickly, so we might be able to start to customize scopes for ergonomics as well. Just to comment, we'll just finish cutting a little bit, but at the end we'll play 2 clips at the base to make sure we ensure no delayed perforation.